if you ask with them. When you ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach.
We've had, I think, 3 now different 2-year-olds who have memorized the whole book of James. The entire book of James for 20 minutes and having so much fun with it.
Welcome to Bible Memory Goal. My name's Josh, and you just heard from Catherine Wittenmyer, who along with her sister Rose, her brother Andrew, and their family friend Herbert, they run the Buy the Book online resource for scripture memory that is meant to encourage people of all ages, even going down to 2 years old, to memorize scripture and understand that they can memorize more than they think that they can. In this conversation, we're going to dive into their methodology. How are they able to teach people of such varying ages so quickly to memorize scripture? And considering previous conversations having to do with orality and oral cultures, how might that be applicable around the world as well? To start things off, though, they shared the influence that their mother had on not just their scripture memory, but also the development of their character.
So it was in 2016. Our mom was an amazing homeschool mom, very biblical, and just did a spectacular job of, you know, every time there's a tiny little twitch with our siblings that most people would just sweep under the rug or not even notice. She knew us better than we knew ourselves and would bring the Bible into every single moment of everyday life. And then in 2016, she very suddenly out of the blue got brain cancer. And so she lost her ability to walk and talk and move and remember my name and things like that. But she started to relearn how to talk and said that she wanted to memorize Proverbs chapter 31, which is pretty crazy considering that she couldn't remember my name as her daughter. But we remembered just from some previous Bible memory stuff that when you put it to music, sometimes you're able to memorize things that you can't memorize normally. And so we put it to a song, and Mom was able to memorize Proverbs chapter 31 to a song. And then after that, just realized it could be a huge blessing to the people in our church, started asking if we could do that more, and brought us to today when we're,
And that's great. And I'm only saying this because I want to make sure that the story wraps on you know, she passed away. What point?
Yeah, she passed away in 2017. And that was really the instigation of so many, like God just brought so much good out of that. That's what made our character what it needed to be in order to do this. And, God just brought so much good out of it, even through her death. So.
Yeah. We were talking about this prior to recording, where I think there's something about these defining moments in our life that are usually marked by some kind of suffering, right? And it's the kind of suffering that I feel like in the church we often try to avoid as much as we can, and yet it's that suffering that really develops our character. It's the suffering and the kind of the challenges that, you know, push us to seek after God in a more focused way. I mean, it's kind of like lifting weights, where if you lift no weight at all, the benefit isn't as good as if you were to try to actually lift something that is a challenge that's pushing back on you. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Therefore, you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that we may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. And so, yeah.
James chapter 1. So that's true. Awesome. Yeah. Well, one of the things that you guys say on your website that I thought was really fascinating, and I hadn't heard this before, but that each of us, and that includes people that are watching or listening to this right now, have likely memorized the equivalent of 7% of the whole Bible. Explain what that means. What do you mean by that? That feels like, wait a second, what do you mean 7%? It's 6.83% exactly.
Yeah, well, basically, you know, you think of how many songs we accidentally have memorized that we don't even try to memorize, just from whether it's hearing them on the radio or in the store, they're just on our playlist. And a lot of the times those songs can be just, whatever, either whether they're not necessarily bad, but they're just content words that have been memorized. But what if we use that same concept of our brains accidentally memorizing big passages of texts, but actually do that to memorize the Word of God? And so where that comes in, if you do the math, I think the math is on the site there, but if the average American, you know, memorizes on average this amount of songs, you do the number of words, it adds up to a ridiculously large amount of text that we memorize. And that just goes to show that a lot of people say, I'm not smart enough to memorize, or that's really hard to memorize. It's a challenge. But if we think about, oh, how much have we actually memorized, maybe more of us are auditory memorizers than we think. So, yeah.
Or I remember when, actually, just right around the time when Mom was sick and just after she passed away, I tried memorizing the book of Ephesians. And for me, it was honestly really discouraging because I put so much effort into memorizing it and I got it, barely. But then a few weeks, a few months later, and I've forgotten it all. And I'm like, what was the point? And yeah, there was a lot of spiritual benefit that was gained from it, but it was kind of discouraging. And so actually halfway through memorizing Ephesians, I tried to put the second half of Ephesians to a song. And so I memorized the first half, just rote memory, and the second half to a song. And to this day, I mean, it's been 6 years now. The first half, I can say a few phrases here and there, a few words. I recognize it, I understand the concepts, but I couldn't recite it to you. But the second half, even after almost no review, I could still recite that word perfect. And that's just the power that a song has. Because when you memorize rote, your brain has to remember every single word in the order that it comes in. But when you memorize something to music, you memorize the first word and the rest comes as a big long string and it goes straight into long-term memory, which is such a blessing. And I know you've talked about that in some of your previous episodes. Yeah. But,
well, yeah, one of my favorite lines was, oh, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. Oh, I was just saying it was funny. So one of the professors at college almost had a challenge for extra credit. If anyone could memorize, you know, could recite to me an entire, you know, big chunk of history from scripture, and no one has ever taken him up on this offer. And then Catherine came up and I think she ran it through once in her head, Acts 7 that you hadn't reviewed for four or 5 years. And then she just blah, 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 recited it and it was great. And it's just the power of, you know, long-term memorization is so much more easy and efficient for review when we're memorizing to music versus when we're memorizing rote, it can be more challenging.
Yeah. I think it's one of my favorite lines that a gentleman that I'd interviewed a couple weeks back named Anthony said. He's like, rote memory is hoping, believing, praying that by saying it over and over and over and over and over again, that you're going to make scripture memory fun. It's not that you're not, I mean, he said, you'll memorize it. It will get memorized. Like we've proven that time and again, but it's not necessarily going to be fun. And then, you know, the retention of what you've memorized may not be as strong as you hope it is. Whereas there are a lot of different techniques, obviously, song being one of them, where we are accessing different parts and different ways of attaching strength to a memory, you know, by adding melody, by adding just rhythm, all of these things that help us to memorize a song. And we've talked about this on this channel a number of times before, using song, but you guys have done something slightly different that I thought was just fascinating, because I went on your website and I looked at some of the videos, and I think I saw what was either a 3-year-old or a 4-year-old kid reciting an entire, was it book of the Bible? What did I see?
You know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect.
The youngest on record that we've had so far is we've had, I think, 3 now different 2-year-olds who have memorized the whole book of James. So 2-year-olds memorizing book of James, and we also had a 2-year-old memorize the Sermon on the Mount and other big check sections like that.
Yeah, the record was a 14-year-old who memorized James in 4 weeks. And I think the particular video that you're referring to was there were 3 kids. One was, I believe, she had 7, yeah. 6, and 3.
She had just turned three.
Yeah. And they're reciting through the whole book of James. And they are having so much fun with it. Usually it's hard to get a 2-3-year-old to sit still for, you know, 20 minutes. But if you look at how long the video is, they are reciting word for word the entire book of James for 20 minutes and having so much fun with it.
And it's quite a remarkable thing to see a child that can barely speak, but when you do understand what they're saying the inspired words of God, and it's like they're playing with their toy train and you can barely hear them mumbling, and you're like, wait, what are you singing? Can you say that louder? And then you realize, oh, they're spewing out words that people write their doctoral dissertations on. Like, do you have any idea the genius words that are coming out of your mouth, 2-year-old? It's just such an encouragement. So,
That is really cool. So explain to me, one of you, kind of go through the process of, all right, you guys are taking a passage. Obviously, you're by the book, so it's not just a short passage. You're taking chapters and or books, and you're putting the entire thing, is it to one song? And who's composing it? What translation are you using? Can you kind of walk us through a little bit of that process for you guys?
Yeah, so the process of taking a large chunk of text and setting it to music, it has so many different nuances, especially with a text like the Bible that isn't symmetric or poetic or has all these different rhyme schemes that aid with your setting it to music and scansion. Mm-hmm. And it really just starts off with what is the most natural way that the text of Scripture is said, and putting that to music, and that being digested by ourselves as we hear it audibly and orally. And so we take a text of Scripture like James chapter 1, and we say, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we say it out loud. And then you pay attention to what was the natural rhythm I said that. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. Or James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. To the 12 tribes in the dispersion, greeting. And there starts to be some type of rhythm and tempo that you start to gravitate towards. And then you also notice, well, there's inflection while I'm saying it. And there's different ways that my voice goes up and down. And that kind of is like the shape of a melody. And it's kind of very natural to how I'm singing something. So you say, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you pay attention where the melody and inflection goes up and down, and eventually you just listen well enough and make it tuneful in a way that it turns out to something like James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the way you sing and the way you say a long text is all natural to how you would say it. And you don't have the benefits of, oh, that rhymed or that was poetic and how many syllables it had, but it's totally something natural that when you listen to it in a musical format, it's like I'm hearing it as if it was spoken, and it's so normal for me, but I digest it as if it was musical and memorable.
But then you guys are taking it even to the next level, because I've seen a lot of people that put, and I've talked with a lot of people who have put psalms or different passages to music. And, you know, some of them kind of play around with the words a little bit in order to make it rhyme in some places or to make it fit. But what I've seen you guys do that's slightly different is now you're filming little kids that are singing this along as well, right? And like making it more of a, I don't want to say a big production, but something where a kid will sit and watch and consume this and without realizing it, start memorizing that passage. Is that right? What are you guys doing there?
Yeah, because ultimately what the goal is, the song is only a mnemonic aid, only in as far as it helps you memorize the passage. A lot of people make scripture songs for the purpose of being scripture and a song. How can we make a better song? Let's make it scripture, and let's make it rhyme, let's pull different translations in, let's make an awesome kind of musical artistic piece that can be a beautiful, fun song, whether it's a church or for worship. But for us, what's kind of unique is doing the song so that when you actually just recite the lyrics, you're just reciting word for word straight scripture through the whole thing.
Yeah, a lot of how we talk about it is the music is really just the glue. It wants to be invisible. The purpose of it is just to get the words in our brain. And then the goal, honestly, is to forget the music. Music is not the end. It's a means to the end. We want to have the music there just to stick the words in your brain. But then the goal is, like Herbert was saying, if you memorize James is servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, after a while, when you've memorized it to a song, the song is what's playing in your head, but then you can just recite it normally and naturally. Kind of our core verse is Deuteronomy 31, where Moses just had this whole long speech giving the law, saying the blessings for obedience, the curses for disobedience. And then it comes to a point when God had something that was so important for his people to memorize, to know for generations and generations. And what does God say to Moses? He says, now therefore, write this song and teach it to the people of Israel. And when they're grown old and they've gone into the land and they've grown up and they've disobeyed me, this song will live unforgotten in the mouths of their offspring and will be a witness for them. And that's kind of our goal here, is to put scripture to music as an outlet so that even, you know, years down the road, a lot of these children are unbelievers. They may be in a believing household, but these, you know, 5 and 6 year olds and 7 year olds might not be believers themselves. But 20 years down the road, 5 years down the road, 10 years down the road, when they're teenagers going through their rebellious phase, they're, you know, wanting to idolize money. But then the first, just that song gets stuck in the head.
You cannot serve both God and money.
And they get this whole Matthew 6 stuck in their head, and they're like, ah! This song confronts them as a witness, just like it did in Deuteronomy's time.
Yeah. I think you bring up a great point, Catherine, about something that I've kind of wrestled with living out in Asia, and that is this idea that, you know, the Israelites, or even just most people at that time when Deuteronomy was written, for example, it was more of an oral culture. It wasn't a written culture as much as we have nowadays. And that still exists. I think sometimes when we live in our, you know, American bubble or Western bubble in general, we kind of forget that there are still cultures around the world that are primarily oral, right? So they communicate orally. They communicate most information orally. I've heard it said a lot of times for the people that I'm, you know, live among here in Thailand, that most of them don't read more than the equivalent of two sentences a week, like in a book. Like, it's just not part of their culture. It's not because they're dumb. It has nothing to do with their intelligence. It's just, it's not much as part of their culture. And so I've talked with Dr. Larry Dinkins in the past. You guys have probably seen that interview where he is super passionate about stories with these type of oral learners. But what I haven't seen a lot of yet is marrying this idea of music and an oral culture learning, where that can be done almost from, like you said, on a book basis. Because the idea with orality and oral learning sometimes is, hey, we can get this, you know, 10 verse bite-sized story that's usable into their mind and kind of have that repeated. How, if any, have you seen music being used in that way? Can you share some examples of that?
Okay. Yeah. So we've had some opportunities in the past working with some people from Rwanda and from the Congo and from different nations around who have different cultures, including sometimes more of that oral culture, and just being able to put scripture. We had a chance with a group of Congolese refugees who were living in Kansas to put Ephesians chapter 6, the armor of God, into Swahili, and then actually have a counter melody in English, which was really fun. And putting it, like you're saying, into their culture, both musically and just the oral culture. And music is a wonderful opportunity for those cultures that understand better by listening to enable them to listen to whole books of the Bible in a way that doesn't require someone who knows how to read.
And I think, too, it's interesting to think about, again, depending on where God wants us to go, I could see that being a blessing, especially even in persecuted countries where Bibles are literally illegal. You know, how beautiful is that when the body of Christ, and again, ideally we would still, you know, have Bibles so we can have everything, because, you know, I mean, Lord willing, we'll be able to memorize the entire Bible. But at some point, to be able to have books and books and books just lodged in your memory, and then you have that memorized, and you can sneak over to your, you know, other believer and recite and teach them to memorize it in a very catchy song, and they can, and it can kind of spread in that way. So that would be so interesting to see how that plays out among persecuted believers, and just that blessing that can be.
Yeah. Rose, or any of you, I guess, if somebody's listening to this and they're saying, okay, you guys, that's really cute. I love what you think you've got going here. But you don't understand. My brain just cannot, like, I can barely memorize one verse, much less an entire book. Where would you have them start based on the resources that you guys have to say, no, actually, you can. Why don't you start here and see how it goes?
Yeah, so right now we have the book of James, the Sermon on the Mount, the book of Malachi, and First John, and then a couple different various Psalms and Proverbs around. And you'll notice on there that we've played with a bunch of different kind of styles. So for instance, Malachi, so So James, Sermon on the Mount, 1 John have been more very targeted towards children. There's a lot of kind of funny, playful, charming things in there. Whereas Malachi, we started branching out and saying, okay, what would this look like if it was targeted towards more an older age range? And so you'll see kind of a difference there.
Yeah, and so for anyone that thinks that they can't memorize, I would encourage just to honestly give music a try. I definitely, as someone that, and even more so Rose, memory can be hard and it can be discouraging. For me, definitely, Bible memory was very discouraging, but God designed our brains to work in different ways. And if you haven't tried doing it to music, I'd say give it a try. It might turn out to be an encouragement and just a tool that God can use. So yeah, give it a try.
Yeah. Is there anything that I haven't covered or any part of this that you would want to, you wish you could have said? You had something written down, you're like, this is something I really wanted to say.
Yeah, I was just going to say, it's just the power of the Word of God. Like, you know, and we all know that. I mean, this is a Bible memory podcast, and we know the power of the Word of God. But just actually seeing that transformation, and not just, like James says, but be doers of the Word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. If anyone is a hearer of the Word and not a doer, he's like a man who looks intently at his natural face in the mirror. He looks at himself and goes away and once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. And I think in this Christian culture, especially among people who are memorizers and enjoy memorizing, and are avid memorizers who memorize a lot, and that's their joy, it's easy to just be memorizers and just have it in your brain, but not have it in your heart. And it's our responsibility and duty. The reason why we memorize is because we just love our God so much and we want to know as much as there is to know about our God so that we can fall more madly in love with him and be more obedient and serve him better. And so that would kind of be my main encouragement to people who are memorizing, is don't just be a hearer.
I hope you enjoyed that conversation with Catherine, Rose, Andrew, and Herbert. If you want to learn more about what they're doing, you can go to buythebookthebible.com. You'll find all the online resources that they have there. And I think it's worth mentioning that the first time I came in contact with Rose was in our online community. If you are somebody that loves memorizing scripture and you feel like you're alone in doing it, I encourage you to join us, biblememorygoal.com/join. We have a global community of people, all different languages, that are memorizing the Bible and encouraging and inspiring each other in this place. So be sure to join that community and then watch interviews with other inspiring people who are also prioritizing scripture memory. God bless.